At Los Angeles International Airport, Benny Carter prepares to make another journey.
I'll get this. I'll take these. Thank you, sir. Right? Bye, my dear.
Bye.
Take care. Good to see you. And thank you for the trip.
Have a great trip,
Daddy. We'll talk to you tomorrow.
Fine.
All right.
With his wife, Hilma, Benny Carter has traveled far through many years of change. Yet his carry-on luggage always includes one indispensable item, his alto saxophone. In Washington, Carter is honored as one of the great men of American music.
Thank you very much. This is a great moment for me. I have long been bothered by the credit given to one musician after another about having made jazz respectable or made jazz a lady. I'd like to say that if Louis Armstrong and Duke Ellington didn't make jazz respectable, no one else could. Okay? I am most grateful to the Capital City Jazz Festival for deeming me worthy of this award. Thank you very much.
He delights the audience with one of his best-known compositions, leading the American Jazz Orchestra in Doozy. There's a timelessness to Benny Carter, and to his unparalleled career as composer, arranger, soloist, and leader. People always ask me about the good old days, he says, but my good old days are here and now.
He's everything that a musician would want to be. And I always feel proud because all the musicians respect Benny Carter. When you say that word, for many years, it's been Benny Carter.
I remember Benny from my earliest days as probably, with the possible exception of Ellington, the most rounded and the most sophisticated of all the jazz composers. Before and since.
He's the consummate musician. He's a tremendous writer, arranger, saxophone player, trumpet player, and he, more than anyone else, I think, is represents what American music is all about.
I was born in the Bronx,
in 1907. And we moved when I was rather young, I guess probably 1 or 2 years old, to downtown New York, 63rd Street, an area which was known as San Juan Hill. My father did various things at various times, eventually winding up as a post office clerk. And my mother was a domestic worker who also played the piano in church. She was a dedicated church worker.
In a poor neighborhood where frustration sometimes exploded, young Bennett Lester Carter was steadied by his devoted family. But when in the eighth grade a teacher knocked him down in a racial incident, the boy struck back. Expelled, he found few roads were open, but in his heart, Carter had already made a choice.
I had a neighborhood friend who was a few years older than I was, but he was playing with the Duke Ellington Orchestra, and his name was Bubba Miley, and he used to let me carry his trumpet from our street to the subway station when he was going uptown to play with the orchestra, and I just thought that was just wonderful. I was so influenced and inspired by him and by my cousin Cuban Bennett that I finally bought a trumpet myself. I put $1 a week on this trumpet, which I had seen in a pawn shop window, and it was $33, and at the end of the 33rd week, I couldn't wait to get my hands on that trumpet. I got it on a Saturday, and I thought that I was going to be an instant Bubba Miley on Sunday. Didn't work quite like that. So on Monday, I went back and got the C melody saxophone. I didn't get too much encouragement from the family because they didn't realize how serious I was. But after a number of months, when they realized that I was very, very serious, and the only way that I could get a real job with a real orchestra was to be playing the E-flat alto saxophone. So I was taken downtown and a brand new instrument put into my hand, which I forthwith put into my mouth.
For countless hours in the 68 years that followed, Carter has traveled the world in pursuit of musical excellence. He has mastered not only the saxophone, but the trumpet and the clarinet as well. His career, an ongoing symphony and riffs. Tonight he will play at Carlos One, a Greenwich Village club. It's another stop on his own inner journey, a continuing search for musical destinations he has yet to find.
Mr. Carter.
Thank you very much. Good evening.
Hi. Great, great.
How are you tonight?
Great.
All right.
And I have a great
good
reward.
Evening. How are you? Nice to see you again.
Fabulous good. Reward afterwards for you.
Really?
All seafood.
All seafood.
All seafood.
Only the best here.
Only the best.
Thank you very much. All right.
Though more famed for his virtuosity on the alto sax, the trumpet remains his favorite instrument. One of the sole survivors of America's richest musical eras, Carter maintains a performing schedule that others would find daunting.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Tonight we have a very, very special treat. A living legend, man who has made major contribution to the arts. Ladies and gentlemen, would you join me in saying thanks and welcome to the fabulous Mr. Benny Carter.
It was in New York of the 20s and Prohibition that Carter first joined the history of jazz. Despite his mother's fears for his morals, the 15-year-old boy began his apprenticeship in clubs, filling in as a sideman. Largely self-taught as a musician, by 1926 he had become a regular in Charlie Johnson's band at Small's Paradise in Harlem. A year later, he had written a song with Fats Waller and won an ally in famed arranger Don Redman.
The first band that I had was in 1928. It had originally been the Horace Henderson Wilberforce Collegians from Wilberforce University in Xenia, Ohio. We were on the road, and for some reason, Horace saw fit to leave the group, and I was elected by the other members to be the leader.
One of the group's first engagements was in 1928 at Harlem's Savoy Ballroom. Already praised as a soloist for his innovative style and pure tone, he quickly earned his musicians' respect for his quiet leadership and exacting standards. Often members of the band would remain with Carter at lower pay simply for the joy of playing his challenging music. Just 21, his career was on the rise. And so indeed was the Wall Street stock market. But then in late 1929 came the crash. And after it, depression breadlines, silent factories, violent collisions between police and jobless workers. Unable to keep his band sufficiently employed, Carter in 1930 joined Fletcher Henderson's orchestra and toured with it as an arranger and soloist for over a year. Soon after, he became musical director of the legendary McKinney's Cotton Pickers. Never a flamboyant showman like Ellington or Calloway, Carter was the complete musician who would become one of the principal architects of the big band style. In spite of the Depression, Harlem in the early 30s was rich in music and cultural expression. Now married and with a daughter, Joyce, Carter put together a new orchestra, played at ballrooms uptown and along Broadway.
I was very fortunate in 1933 in having a dear friend named George Rich. George was what we called in Harlem in those days a sportsman, which meant that he was involved in many enterprises. I can't say that they were legal or illegal according to the times, but he was quite wealthy. And he helped me very, very much with my orchestra. And when there was a pianist that I wanted to get from Chicago, he drove me to Chicago in his brand new Cadillac to help get Teddy Wilson. In addition to that, John Hammond loaned me $150 to finance my trip because I had no money. So that's how I happened to get Teddy Wilson to come to New York.
Now at Carlos One, Carter has turned to the alto sax for a mellow moment in the evening. With Lyle Atkinson on bass and James Williams at the piano, he again shares with his listeners the flawless tone, the effortless style that have become his signature. Along with the great Johnny Hodges, Carter shaped the style of playing on the alto saxophone. More than any other practitioner of the instrument, he has shown that jazz can be elegant, sophisticated, and still swing. Years have passed since Carter carried Bubba Miley's trumpet to the subway, and much has changed. The jungle of San Juan Hill has been erased to build Lincoln Center, the great cultural citadel. Carter now rides up the island of Manhattan in a limousine, an honored citizen coming back to visit the old Harlem neighborhood that he left behind. At the Apollo Theater, he is greeted by Ralph Cooper, master of ceremonies when Carter opened the theater's big band era in 1934.
Oh, hey! Benny. How you feel, old buddy?
Man.
How are you?
You look wonderful.
You look absolutely great.
I don't know what to say about you. You look fantastic.
Well, listen.
I haven't seen you in 20 years, and you haven't changed a bit.
They're good 20 years.
You know what I want to know?
What's that?
When are they going to change it for the Ralph Cooper Theater?
Oh, that's wonderful. Come on, let me show you the theater.
I'd love to see
it. It's altogether different. Oh. I want you ladies and gentlemen over there to know that this is Benny Carter. Hi. One of the greatest musicians in the world. Let's give him a nice big hand right now.
Thank you.
There you go. Let me hear you say yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
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 All right, me and you.
Right. Here Carter again sees one of the last remaining landmarks from the glory days of the 30s and one of the first big stops on his career. It was hard work and a long day, 4 or 5 shows beginning at 11 o'clock in the morning with a little nap between cues if you could grab it. But playing on this stage with Billie Holiday and other jazz greats, you got your best pay from the crowd sitting in the dark.
And look up at this balcony there.
Oh,
see,
my goodness.
See how gorgeous looks now. Oh, see how beautiful that looks now? Now, you know, one of the things that happened with you, if you remember, you were only to be here 1 week.
That's right. That's what my contract read.
Right. But you were sensational, and you were here for 2 weeks. As a matter of fact, that was the conduit for the big bands that came into play. The Hamptons and the Basies and the Ellingtons and all of the big bands. That
Charlie Barnett, even.
Yes, Charlie Barnett played here.
Sure.
And that was an era that was really great.
Oh, it was wonderful.
It was really, really great because these big bands used to come in here and really whack.
Yes, sir. Know. Let me tell you an interesting little thing that happened to me about 3 weeks ago. I did a concert in Washington.
Yeah.
And one of the ladies came to me, she was a young lady, probably in her 30s, and she said, my mother wanted to send her regards to you. And she gave me a list here of the chorus line of the first week at the Apollo.
Really?
And she said, my mother was one of them. And she started reading off the list, and every one just gave me a little
nudge. Yeah, a little nudge.
Oh, of course. I could remember practically everyone. And that was a great line.
Oh,
these girls were all wonderful lookers and great dancers.
Right, they certainly were.
And lovely girls.
Right, well, we don't have that anymore.
I know.
It's a little different now, but it's exciting.
Yes. Yeah.
And if you would come up on an amateur night and be my guest.
I'll be delighted.
Benny,
when I'm in town.
It would just be fabulous because
these people
will love you.
We'll do it.
In 1935, hardly a year after the Apollo opening, as Carter faced hard times and a failed marriage, Paris beckoned with a nightclub offer. But it would be a quick round trip back to New York. Rashly, he had taken young Joyce with him without her mother's consent. Realizing his error, he cabled his estranged wife and returned only to find plainclothesmen waiting to arrest him. Though Benny smiled for the press photographers, he was more concerned with consoling his anxious daughter. Later in court, the charges were dismissed, and Carter would return to France alone. In Europe, Nazis and racial bigots were on the march. Yet paradoxically, here he would find new appreciation of his stature as a musician.
I found Paris in those days very, very interesting, very open. When I say open, of course, you could drink 24 hours a day, you know, and many of us did. We'd all meet after our respective jobs and exchange ideas and have a lot of laughs. And I thought this was a great opportunity for me to see a little bit of the other world and be exposed to another culture.
American jazz, with its freedom and vitality, was taken seriously in Europe. In London, Carter would find that here, too, he already had a devoted following.
national program from London. Now you're going to hear the first performance of the new BBC Dance Orchestra, directed by Henry Hall.
Hello, everyone. This is Henry Hall speaking.
Invited to England by Henry Hall, leader of the BBC Dance Orchestra, and Leonard Feather, a noted English jazz authority, Carter found himself welcomed as a celebrity in the headlines, hailed as King.
I think Benny probably found in England a reaction and a response to his presence that was unlike anything he had known in his own country. Not that he wasn't respected among a large number of musicians in the United States, but when he came to England, he was front page news. Week after week, there'd be stories about where he was going, what he was doing, the records. I mean, Benny was big news.
Unable to perform publicly because of restrictive labor laws, Carter could only work as an arranger and make recordings.
The first session that Benny made in England was particularly noteworthy, not only because it was the first of its kind with a great American musician conducting an old British band, but also because one of the tunes featured Benny on tenor saxophone, an instrument he had never recorded on before, and for which he wrote a really beautiful ballad called Nightfall. And on the others, he played trumpet and alto saxophone and clarinet, sometimes all three on the single record. Then there were several other originals, something called Swing and Made a Veil, that was the name of the studio where we recorded. And he had a few other musicians, ad-libs, some blues in three-quarter time, and that was the record we called Waltzing the Blues. There were no jazz records in three-four time, no jazz waltzes. So as a result of that, a controversy erupted that would produce one of Benny's most talked about recordings.
At last, British fans won permission for Carter to give a concert at London's Hippodrome. It was sold out. A sensation with critics and public alike. Carter would respond in the relaxed warmth of a song he wrote and recorded in England, When Lights Are Low.
Sweet music, soft and mellow, soothing and slow. Strains of a mellow shallow when lights are low. Dear, we're so close together, I love you so. Why think about the weather when lights are low?
Danish bandleader Kai Evans, who had brought Louis Armstrong to Denmark, arranged for Carter to perform and record with the popular Evans Band in Copenhagen.
On my first trip to Denmark, I was on the boat train going from Esbjerg to Copenhagen, and I knew that this Otto of Habsburg was on the train. I think he was either Crown Prince or something of Austria. And as we drove into the station, I saw this crowd of people whom I was absolutely certain they were there for him. And as I was standing at the window of the train in the corridor, somebody pointed to me and said, there he is. And then they all converged upon the train that I was on. Gee, I was just taken onto the shoulders of people and taken somewhere for a great reception that was really tumultuous.
Carter was praised for his musical invention and subtlety, and his concerts in Denmark, Sweden, and the Low Countries often resembled a triumphal tour. Avoiding Nazi Germany, he would form in Holland his own reply to the master race.
Sometime in the spring of 1937, Benny received an offer to take a band to Holland. I think it was a 12-piece orchestra, to do a summer seaside gig at Scheveningen on the Dutch coast. And to do that, he put together an ensemble of musicians that simply consisted of the best people he could find. And some of them were British, a couple were Scottish, a couple of West Indians, one or two Americans. And the interesting thing is that this made it, unbeknownst to many people who give Benny Goodman a lot of credit, the first real interracial, international orchestra ever to play jazz anywhere, as far as I know.
After 3 years abroad, Carter was anxious to return to the musical mainstream and the city he'd left behind.
Things seemed to be going pretty well for the big bands in 1938. And I kind of had a feeling that if I came back, maybe I could put a band together and have a greater measure of success with the band than I had had previous to my going to Europe. Also, I sort of had a great feeling of wanting to hear American musicians play my music.
Soon he was back at the Savoy Ballroom, warmly welcomed by its dancing guests and playing in his own national radio broadcasts. The big band sound which Carter had helped create was sweeping the country. Swing was in.
The Savoy Ballroom was a wonderful place in which to play. The most exciting thing about the Savoy Room was watching those dancers and playing for them. They were really inspiring. The Lindy Hop and the Jitterbugs, and they did such wonderful things. I think some of the dancers had to be acrobats.
Time once again to cut short another visit with Benny Carter, his trumpet, his saxophone, and his orchestra. The program originates...
Today, playing more for listeners than dancers, Carter can take time to deal with the problem.
I gotta explain this to you, really. I hate to bother you with this story, but this is the actual truth. There's a note I've been looking for on this horn for a couple of years now. Now, that's a long time, trying to find one note. I am just so hard at it because I know it's in there. I heard it on a Miles Davis record. It's gotta be there. Well, Amy's got a different horn.
In there.
By the early 40s, Carter was leading smaller groups in 52nd Street clubs, but he was still drawn to the big band sound. Audiences and greater success, he assembled a new orchestra. For weeks, Carter and his musicians faced the ordeal of a tour through the segregated South. 23 states in 6 weeks. Later, in the North, conditions were better. But often during the grueling one-night stands, the musicians would shake their heads when they awoke, trying to remember where they were. Gradually, they zigzagged westward, from Indianapolis out to Portland, Salt Lake City, and stops between. At last, Carter arrived in Los Angeles. Quickly called upon by Hollywood to arrange and compose for the movies, he also appeared on screen, leading his band for Lena Horne's singing of Honeysuckle Rose. A hit at the swing club and other night spots, in demand at the studios, still taking his band on an occasional tour, or recording classics such as I Surrender, Dear, he He was the hottest thing in town. Though the big band era would fade in the next few years, Carter would make Hollywood his home. Abroad, war was raging in Europe. A segregated United States Army had entered World War II. Exempt from service because of an early arm injury, Carter recorded many shows for the Army's Jubilee broadcasts for troops overseas.
Backwards, it's Belzile Booze. Now, brethren, what have you got? You've got Jubilee!
Well, Benny, welcome back to old Elabouge.
Thanks, Ernie. It's a pleasure to be back.
What's first up?
This is almost a jump tune.
What do you mean, almost a jump tune?
Well, this is just a hop, skip, and...
Oh, just so it isn't long hair.
Long hair? Why, Ernie, this hair is so short it's ingrown.
Then clip us, Benny, clip us.
Carter also led his band in more than 50 engagements at military training camps around the country for servicemen black and white.
And things will come your way.
Patience and fortitude might win the war, but for blacks, equal risk rated equal rights, a question still to be settled. At home, listeners enjoyed a new and somewhat untypical novelty song by Carter and his collaborators. Sung by Ella Mae Morse, Cow Cow Boogie was one of the hit records of the wartime years.
Get along, get hip, little doggies, get along. Better be on your way, get along. Get hip, little doggies, and he trucked them on down the old fair way. Singing his cow cow boogie in the strangest way. Come a die.
Now Carter prepares to make a new album. He has composed and arranged music for one of his specialties, the saxophone ensemble.
Oh, wait a minute. At bar 11, what do you got there, rhythm? I have the wrong note.
Rehearsing with him in the all-star group are longtime colleagues, such as bassist Milt Hinton.
Prior to that, I'm afraid that they might go to a B-flat seventh, incorporating the D natural to go back between solos. Is that profound thinking or what? Now, this blues thing, let's do this one more time. Can everybody take 2 12-bar chords?
On his way to the recording studio in Manhattan, Carter goes over the details in his mind. More than 60 years after making his first record, and after hundreds of sessions with top jazz and popular artists, he knows the pressure of performing on cue.
Without the EQ in, it sounded muddy.
Bottom on the back.
Well, we brought down the level a little bit, too.
You're first, huh? I'm second.
Two, three.
I've been fortunate enough to win a couple of awards in the past, but this is very, very special. Not only because it's given to me as recognition from my peers, but recognition from my people. Thank you so much.
Benny opened up the eyes of a lot of producers and studios so that they could understand that you can go to blacks for other things outside of blues and barbecue, you know. He had a wide range of ability. He had classical training. He's a total musician. And I know that the problems that I had, even as late as the 60s, you know, Benny's must have been 10 times rougher. Benny was a pioneer. He was the foundation. He made it possible for that doubt to be taken away.
In his many-sided career, Carter would score or perform in more than 30 feature films with stars such as Nat King Cole, compose the music for television series and the acclaimed animated films of John and Faith Hubley. Today, Carter remains as creative and productive as ever. His home in the hills overlooking Los Angeles provides a quiet haven from his busy schedule on the road. In his study, lined with awards and shelves of music, he continues his search for new melodies and the secrets hidden in a sound. When it comes to composing, he says, I'm a pack rat. I never throw anything away.
If you look at the overall history of jazz, there have been a great many wonderful performers. There have been very few great composers. Ellington, obviously, and then Benny. I mean, Benny has written more things, and he covers all the eras, because it goes all the way back to Fletcher Henderson, and he probably wrote something last week that we'd all like. And so styles come and styles go, but that kind of particular brand of sophistication that he has when he writes, and the particular kind of elegance in his phrasing and in his thinking, transcends whatever the vogue or the mode of the day is. And there's never been anything quite like Benny.
But success has not come easily. Carter has been witness to many changes since the era when nightclub bands could be black, but only whites were allowed to dance. Once questioned whether his pianist was white or black, Carter replied, I never asked him. When he first arrived in Los Angeles, blacks were kept from buying homes in white areas through restrictive housing covenants. Many black families protested this injustice, but though Carter seldom provoked battle, he never ran away from it. Challenged in the 1940s when he bought a house in a racially restricted area, Carter fought the case in court and won.
By the late 1940s, it had become obvious that it was ridiculous to have two separate musicians' unions, particularly when the black union was being excluded from a lot of the important jobs. The scales for nightclubs in the black union were lower than the scale for the white union and so forth. So Benny, along with Marl Young and Buddy Collette and some white musicians, felt that the time had come to amalgamate the two locals. And he played one of the more important parts in bringing about that amalgamation, which finally did take place in 1953. But the way he's fought all his life is in a very quiet, dignified way, without making too many waves. And I think, in a sense, it's just an extension of the Golden Rule.
We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal.
In the 1960s, Americans began to come together in a new era of support of equal rights for all citizens.
Coleman Hawkins.
In the 1970s, Carter undertook what he would call his education decade. At the Duke Ellington High School for the Arts in Washington, and at schools and colleges around the country, he has taught and lectured. A visiting professor at Princeton University, he was awarded an honorary doctorate, is still glowingly remembered by his former students.
He was just such a warm person, and before he even had any idea if I could play or not, he was gracious, and he said, "I want to hear you. I just want to hear your music." To him, it wasn't just a thing of how good is this guy, but it was just a thing of, well, here's the musician. He plays from his heart. I want to hear his heart. It was great.
To the members of a master class at the University of New Hampshire, Carter plays the gentle role of an older companion, sharing his long and varied experience.
It sounds kind of, every phrase sounds a little too planned for me.
I'm gonna do this here, I'm gonna do that there, but I don't really feel it. Now that, this is all personal, of course. The intonation, the quality of the voices, excellent, I think, you know, and we'll get better. That's not being too harsh, is it?
Always modest about his own place in music history, he is proud of his efforts as teacher. "I like the scholarly atmosphere," he says, "the civilized tranquility, the chance to get to know students and faculty members. These are experiences and memories I cherish."
Mr. Benny Carter and his orchestra, Benny Carter.
But across the Pacific, Carter, the performer, is king. Japan has caught the beat. Since his first Jazz at the Philharmonic performance here in 1953, Carter's many visits have earned him a host of loyal fans. To a nation accustomed to the polite, plucked phrases of the samisen, the sounds of American jazz have a special magic. As always, the tour is a breathtaking succession of rehearsals and renewed friendships, of cities and concerts and clapping hands, of late-night sushi, of packing and catching the bullet train, passing through the rice fields and the factories of an old and new Japan.
Ooh, baby, what you've got, nobody has, and I've got you, and all that jazz. And then, you know, yeah, you know, then... I'll probably let Bucky play some in here, unless somebody wants to play it in here, you know, if it's a funny tune, you know. And then at the end, on the end, jazz me a four-bar ending. You know what I mean? Jazz, just jazz out.
Mm-hmm.
You have got the lips that suit my taste, and your fingertips can't be replaced. Ooh, baby, what you've got, nobody has. And I've got you, and I've got you, and I've got you, and all that jazz.
But sometimes the clapping stopped.
I was sitting at my work table one evening, writing some music for a television show, when I got a call from a friend informing me that Johnny Hodges had just died. And I was very shocked and saddened by the news, and I turned to the piano immediately, and I guess even without thinking, I just started playing, and out came a tune, which I now call Souvenir. Johnny Hodges was one of our great, great saxophonists, great musician, and also a contemporary. And I now use Souvenir to dedicate to the memory of all of our past fallen jazz greats.
Recently, Benny and Hilmer joined a magnificent gathering of performers and hundreds of fans on a cruise to the Caribbean. Under sunny skies and soft winds aboard the SS Norway, the floating jazz festival never stops. It's a melting pot of exciting sounds, joyous and spontaneous feelings, the essence of jazz.
All of me, Cloud. Why not take all of me? What the hell would I want with all of you?
At a theater on board, fans are delighted when trumpeter Clark Terry and Carter break into an impromptu duet.
You show me no tricks on that
horn. No, I know you got all the tricks on. That's why I know you're the king, because you know how to make that thing swing.
Oh, yeah. You know how to make that thing
talk. Oh, no, I don't. Oh, sis, me, but that
feeling that will do that.
Happy indeed to be the center of all of these illustrious gentlemen here, all of whom I've respected and admired since I was a mere boy. And of course, as you know, from leading on my right is Buddy Tate. And a little more closer to my right is Mr. Illinois Jackett. To my immediate left, Mr. Flip Phillips. And to his left, Mr. Red Holloway.
During the cruise, there's plenty of time for the fans to get to know the musicians they love. For Carter, it's an opportunity to talk about the movie cliches so often associated with jazz.
You know, will they ever make a film about a black musician a la the Glenn Miller story, the Benny Goodman story?
Yeah.
When they're prepared to make something else other than a suffering, addicted black jazz musician, I'll go see it.
As great as Ben Webster was on the saxophone, he talked about Benny Carter all day. All night, King Carter, you know, Benny, you know, this is the king here. He's alive here.
Yeah.
Lee,
how are you feeling?
I have pictures
nice to see
of you.
You.
Yeah.
Oh, Joe Siegel, of course, yes. In the Blackstone Hotel, of course, yes.
Appreciate your comments.
Huh?
I appreciate your comments about
you
the
did.
Film.
Thank you very much.
Benny, what do you think of the future of jazz?
I hope to see how
you know, we
you
got
do.
A lot of young musicians coming up.
I think
it's a big future.
I think the future's got to take care of itself.
Okay.
I can't predict.
You can't predict, huh?
No way.
During the stop at St. Martin Island, many of the passengers go ashore. It's a chance for the Carters to catch up on some shopping. Hilma, a retired teacher, and Benny first met in the early 40s. Years later, they were reacquainted and married. Hilma is a constant supporter and accompanies Benny on all his travels. Back on the ship, Carter reminisces with his old friend, Dizzy Gillespie.
Yeah. I remember when my jaw didn't come out right there.
Really?
Yeah, when I was with a...
cab?
Driving a cab, uh-huh. Man. Yeah, I didn't have no big jaw at all.
But that's why what you do, although it's impossible, you don't seem to know it.
Oh, yes, sir, boy. That was one of the highlights of my whole life. Playing with you down there at that big
well,
thing.
That
we had so many. Yeah, the clarinet player from Cleveland.
Al Gibson.
Al Gibson will play with me later, Barrett.
That's right, Al Gibson. And
Kenny Clark and Sonny
Kenny
White.
Kenny Clark on drums, Sonny White on piano.
So there's a lot of musicians come out of that era, and I stole from all of them. Yeah,
well,
all of them.
That's the way I say.
Yeah.
I don't say I borrowed.
I stole.
I'm not gonna give it back.
No,
You can take it, but I'm not gonna give it.
Yeah.
Right.
For Benny Carter, 82 years have been a crowded journey. The boy from San Juan Hill has become a citizen of the world. In a time still afflicted by stale hatreds, he has enriched us with his dignity and his humanity and his art. Yet crossing the landscape of history, he has never stopped listening for the melody waiting in the silence.